When starting any new course of study, there are going to be some terminology that you have to learn that you're going to hear quite a bit. And one of those terms in genetic genealogy is haplogroup. You've probably heard this. You might have tested and been told what your haplogroup is. And you may be wondering, okay, well, it's these letters here, but what does that actually mean? Today, I'm going to go over what a haplogroup is and what those letters might actually mean for you. So the first thing we can learn from this term haplogroup is group. It's a group, a bunch of people in this case. But what do those people have in common? Well, we can look at some maps here. And these maps show an origination point and different letters going all over. In this case, this is the Y-DNA map. And you can see that it starts in Africa and spreads out from there all around the world. There's also one for mitochondrial DNA. And of course, it starts in Africa as well and then spreads out. One of the things that you notice just between these two maps is in the Y-DNA map, the map starts with the letter A and branches off from there into the other letters. While with the mitochondrial DNA map, the map starts with the letter L and then goes off, and A's not until much later on. And this actually has to do with how this research into these DNA sets worked. Mitochondrial DNA was the first set of DNA to actually be researched, really because it's much smaller. And it was researched in particular in relation to North American natives. And so we see that A, B, C, and D, the first four letters of the alphabet, are really the first four haplogroups that were found when they were researching this. And from there, they started tracing back. And as they found more, there was other letters added. We get to the origination of all human life in Africa. And we were at letter L by that time already. So that started because of a specific research project in regards to North American ancestry, which is why those haplogroup letters don't necessarily make sense when we're talking about the origin of the human species. On the other hand, Y-DNA, which is much longer, we already had the information from mitochondrial DNA, and so a much more logical approach was used. We started with the letter A, with the beginning of civilization there in Africa, and that then spread out, branching off each time. So you see that the Americas, which are actually some of the last places on Earth to be populated, we have haplogroups that are a Q, and then an early one, a C, that actually made it over here on the Y-DNA side. And that shows the migration, which is one of the great things with haplogroups, is by tracing where these haplogroups originated, by who has those haplogroups today, we can start to get an idea about certain migration patterns of humans. And this, of course, can be matched up with other records, as far as sometimes written records for more recent history, but some archaeological evidence for ancient history, to see how humans have actually migrated around the world. But that still doesn't tell us what these letters mean. So in essence, a haplogroup denotes a common set of mutations. And when I'm talking about mutations, I'm talking about SNPs, specific places on our DNA that have had the letter change. So if I go to 23andMe and I pull up my haplogroup report, it's actually going to show me how that haplogroup has migrated and how it has changed over time. So for instance, in this one here, start with the human population for mitochondrial DNA with L. It starts in Africa. There was a genetic mutation that happened, which created L3. Now the person that had that L3 had migrated, and then there was another mutation, N, and that person had migrated to a different part, into the Arabian Peninsula, it looks like here. N then had another mutation, which created haplogroup R, and that was still in the same general area, a little bit further north, which had another mutation, which created U. U had another mutation, which created K. Now, by the time we get to K, we can see that we are into the Caucasus region, right between the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea. So after K, there was a mutation that created K1. It's not shown on here, but then there was another mutation that created K1A, and then another mutation that created K1A3, and finally another mutation that created K1A3A. So Each one of these letters in this path basically represent a mutation. Most of the time a single mutation, but in sometimes there's going to be two or three mutations because they're trying to simplify this down. And with mitochondrial DNA, because it is so short, there's really a very limited number of mutations that create all the haplogroups that we have for mitochondrial DNA. So it's really easy to actually see how they all lay out in this way. With Y-DNA, because it's much longer, there can be a vastly larger amount of those DNA mutations. And so that tree gets much more complicated. But that is what is being shown on these graphs. Every time you see from one letter a migration and a letter change, that represents a mutation that has happened. The migration of the same people may have happened to two different areas. For instance, we can see that this D came out of Africa and looks like over across the Indian subcontinent into Southeast Asia, and then up into the Korea-China area, but also into Japan. And so that's why we see those D. But even within that group then, there's going to be some other mutations that create subgroups. But the other thing that we actually see from these charts is that the places that have been populated for the longest have the most interconnections between them as people have migrated back and forth. Whereas the places that have had either the most recent populations, for instance, the Americas, or the most remote, in this case, Australia, a lot of the movement to Australia happened when there was more of a land bridge between a lot of those islands. And so these isolated places or the more recently populated places have fewer haplogroups that are represented within their populations. So when you see the phrase haplogroup, be thinking of a group of people that have a common set of mutations. And that's what binds this group together, is because they all shared these common ancestors. In a lot of cases, these common ancestors were thousands or tens of thousands of years ago. But it is a way of grouping people based on where their maternal or their paternal line came from. Now, if you'd like to know about how same related people can have different haplogroups, then watch this video up here. But if you are wanting to learn something else about DNA, then watch the video down below. And be sure to subscribe to our channel, click that like button, and join FHF Extra in the join button down below, where you will get more videos and access to monthly webinars that we hold for our members.